Don't tell your mother. Kiss one another. Die for each other. We're cool for the summer. So what's up, guys? So in this video, I basically wanted to discuss the essential nature of what's been going on now that we've had a little bit of time to kind of take in the whole idea about John Boehner being resigning from office, and essentially the fallout and the just general responses that have been generated. In a recent in something that Nancy Pelosi, the former House Speaker, ended up saying, she ended up calling the event of John Boehner's resignation seismic. And given the responses from the Republican Party, I would tend to agree with this statement. The issue at hand has definitely shown a very large seismic shift in the way that politics is run within the GOP, and it is interesting to really note the way that the Republican Party has basically just turned on a man that basically has, well, led them in government for the last several years, and are also turning on Mitch McConnell, who is the Senate Majority Leader. So it really brings into this whole idea that these men that basically pandered to these Tea Party fascists, essentially, for the last several years, have basically prostituted themselves and just literally thrown themselves at the mercy of the Tea Party sect, now find themselves being ridiculed, being pretty much being tossed aside to the point where it almost seems like these men are going to be purged. And let's be honest, these men were going to be purged and removed from their positions of power, no matter what the case was going to be. These men were essentially on their way out because the Tea Party essentially thought that they had become, you know, too progressive, or they were still too moderate to be part of the conservative side of, you know, of the American right-wing political spectrum. And some of these statements that were even made by certain Republicans was quite interesting, actually. One of the things that was actually said was that it was time to, for new leadership, that he subverted our republic. This was something that was actually said by Tom Massey of Kentucky and Tim Wellskamp of Kansas. Now, first of all, let me just say that they believe that it's time for new leadership. I, in some ways, agree with that statement. It is time for new leadership, and personally, I think that you should be changing your government leadership every couple of years to prevent it from getting stale, stagnated, and, well, reactionary. But the whole fact is that when you already have a force that's in government that is already reactionary, the only sense of reactionism that can continue to exist is fascism. And that is exactly what has happened with the GOP. It has systematically turned to fascism. There is no doubt anymore that the GOP is not a conservative party. It is a full-functioning fascist party. And I like the fact that they say that he subverted our republic. Forgive me for saying, but wasn't it the last few years that John Boehner was the man that was essentially prostituting himself to do the bidding of every last Tom, Dick, and Harry that was in the Tea Party, including Ted Cruz, I might add, who caused a government shutdown a few years ago by reading Green Eggs and Ham for 36 hours. Oh, and also the fact that he cost the taxpayers $24 billion. But of course, we'll just ignore all that and blame the dude who is more moderate than your typical fascist right winger. It seems justified, but I find it funny because there's strange parallel comparisons to how the Republicans always would blame Obama for everything that went wrong with the country, and still do. And now, because of the failures of the Republican Party and the fact that they don't think that, you know, that he's being conservative enough, they essentially, anything that goes wrong, they're going to blame their party leadership. They're going to blame somebody like John Boehner or Mitch McConnell. So it kind of leaves us open to pretty much this continual witch hunt, this perpetual witch hunt against members of the Republican Party who basically are not moderate enough. And that right there is a symbol and a sign that the Republican Party is literally fracturing right down the middle. Basically, any member that is not, and this is something I've been saying for a few years, any member of the Republican Party who is not moderate, or who is moderate, excuse me, is basically going to be purged from the party, and is basically going to be forced to resign, leave, or be removed from their positions. And essentially, this group of people is going to be ostracized, and they're going to be alienated to the point where I wouldn't be surprised if they don't end up having to form some sort of a third party, or whether they end up, you know, deciding to form some sort of an alliance or coalition with more moderate or even right-wing Democrats. So there is kind of this interesting dilemma that it definitely exists, because the GOP as it exists now is quite literally moved right towards the third positionist leaning. I mean, let's be honest, when you have more people that probably support your decisions that are third positionists, like the American Third Position, or, you know, any basically ultra-right, ultra-nationalist, and ultra-conservative, and ultra-Christian sort of groups that are supporting your actions, it's obvious that you don't support moderate politics any longer. I mean, this is something that actually brings up an interesting case. Recently, I had a discussion with a friend of mine, and he and I were discussing about how American politics, in politics in general, is usually centered left, right, right along in here. And that this right here would be the American, is supposed to be where the American conservative is. This is where the American liberal is supposed to be. And right in the middle is generally supposed to be where the center is, where moderatism is. And sometimes moderates tend to lean a little bit to the right, a little bit to the left. But typically they're right within that spectrum. And a lot of times some of your moderates will often be libertarians, so they tend to be more on the left. Whereas your civil libertarians, your civil, basically that believe in more progressive ideas, will also be more kind of along the center, on more towards the left. Well, the problem is, in the left-right spectrum, the American right, as far as American conservatism goes, at least in the sense of the GOP, is way over here. They're on the far right, comparable to Mussolini's Italy and Nazi Germany. The American liberal, the American Democrats, anyway, the Democratic Party, has moved right towards the center, if not, you know, leaning, you know, relatively back and forth, right, as I explained just a minute ago. So they basically lean right in the center. And so that basically leaves those that are still the liberals and the Democrats that are probably going to go towards Bernie Sanders, blah, blah, blah. That's not relevant to this video. Whereas the people that don't fall in line to the fascist nature of the GOP, and like John Boehner, Ron Paul, Mitch McConnell, those individuals will probably have to try to find some sort of middle ground, and they're probably going to end up identifying more towards the Democratic groupings, or at least will try to form some sort of coalition with these people at some point in time. If not, form an entirely different party. So essentially, that is where American politics has really ended up. I've been discussing essentially what I believe is the GOP becoming a bit like a dying star, and that it's fading from existence, and members are essentially turning on each other and purging members from the party, much like the Nazis did. And essentially, this seems very apparent when you consider that essentially John Boehner wasn't really going to have much of a choice. He was going to have to basically be resigned from office, or he was going to be removed. And the same thing I can see coming in the next few weeks with Mitch McConnell as well. And so it's really becoming a very... I find that it's becoming a very basically submissive sort of thing where, you know, you are either going to have to fall in line with the party or you're going to have to leave. And this is something that's usually, you don't really see with a lot of partisan politics, and usually when it comes down to the whole issues, you join a party which is, you know, broad in the sense that, you know, you can have mainly whatever beliefs you want, as long as you believe in, you know, the main idea of what the party wants, and essentially the party then hashes out, you know, a relative, you know, populism within that party. Whereas the Tea Party is essentially hijacked the Republican Party itself, and all we have really left is this, is these groups of people that basically believe that unless you believe with our ideology and our ideas, then you don't belong here. And that's not how partisan, how being a member of a party is supposed to work, how being a partisan is supposed to work. Now, I also find that all this is coming, too, after the whole issue going on with the Pope, with a lot of American conservatives turning against, or a lot of even American Christians turning against the Pope, and essentially stating that the Pope and his belief in climate change, in helping the poor, etc., etc., is basically been generating a lot of controversy. And someone like John Boehner is in a position where he's trying to be a better religious family man. He's a Catholic, you know. So the fact that he wants to, that he had this really heartfelt moment with the Pope and actually took some of that consideration to heart and realized that, yeah, you know, maybe we have forgotten what it's like to be true Christians and stuff like that. And it's like, so, you know, maybe he is in some way trying to focus back in on that, yet the Republican Party has completely fucking disowned him because of it. So it really comes down to that whole issue about how you can't serve two masters, and this man decided that he wants to serve, while he wants to basically serve in the capacity to be a religious family man. He wants to have a better connection with God. And while the Tea Party basically wants to serve capitalism, but also at the same time wants to serve a form of Christian democracy in the United States. And number one, I've already said Christian democracy does not work, and the fact that you try to infuse that with capitalism would basically be disastrous. So it's because the difference is that Christianity is a socio-political religious idea, along with it, Christian democracy. Capitalism is a socio-economic religious sort of sect, and you can't obviously have any of those things going on together because they contradict each other, especially considering that in the innate nature of capitalism is basically to make profit and exploit people and basically not give a shit about anybody but your own, you know, your own monetization. Whereas Christianity, like for instance, let's take an example of Jesus Christ, who talked about basically helping the poor, that you didn't have to pay your taxes, and that, that whole thing about how you cannot serve God and money, that you basically have to choose one or the other. So kind of something, I guess, that the Tea Party forgets, and that John Boehner is just finally starting to realize. So I think that's all interesting. Another thing that I found quite interesting was something that Tom Massey, the representative of Kentucky, ended up saying, which was, I think it was inevitable. This is a condition of his own making right here. Once again, John Boehner had no choice. He was either going to have to resign his post, or he was going to be removed physically from the position by a partisan palace coup that was essentially wanting to purge him from the party anyway and disown him, and something that they probably still will do. So yes, it was inevitable, but it was inevitable in the sense that that the making is that entirely of the fascist right in the teabagger sect, not Boehner's. He worked tirelessly for this group of dickwads, prostituting himself, and essentially just had this idea that, you know, if he basically threw himself on the mercy of the Tea Party, that they would take some mercy on him, that they would give him so much praise and everything else, and obviously it's had the opposite effect. Essentially, this is what the thanks that he gets. So hopefully, out of all this, John Boehner and Mitch McConnell and anybody like them has learned their lesson. Don't trust the Tea Party. Don't get involved with the Tea Party. Do not make concessions to the Tea Party, and definitely do not try to appease the Tea Party. You cannot appease a fascist. This is something that should have been learned from Neville Chamberlain when it came down to Adolf Hitler. Neville Chamberlain gave in and appeased Hitler, trying to conserve the peace, essentially. But look where that got them. It got them nowhere, and Hitler ended up invading Poland anyway and the rest of Europe. So, essentially, no good can come from trying to appease a fascist sect. And in this case, any attempt to try to appease the Tea Party is just going to be met with, you know, with absolutely, well, it's going to be met with this sort of shit. They're just going to do what they want anyway, so what's the point in trying to appease them? The only way to actually, the only thing that you can actually do is confront the Tea Party and fight against them, because they are an extremist sect that has hijacked not only the American right, but they have also hijacked the government, the country, and essentially they've hijacked American politics. So, and it also brings up this whole idea about how fascism is capitalism in decay, and with the desperate measures that have existed over the last few years, especially in Europe, and, you know, even the recent crashes and stuff like that in the Asian market, and the scare on Wall Street a few weeks ago, this is all signs about how desperate and extreme the fascist right will actually go. So, anyway, essentially, he had no choice in what the actions that he committed. Now, the honor of, now, I also like what was also said here by Representative David Jolly of Florida. You know, and let me just first, kind of say, anybody that basically comes from Florida is probably going to, any politician that comes out of Florida is probably going to end up having some insane comment. I mean, first of all, let's look at some of the things that have come out of Florida. Bath salts, you know, meth heads, just kind of the things. And I kind of think that also influences the Floridian politics, apparently, as well. No offense if you're from Florida, but let's be honest here. The right wing that's down there is absolutely atrocious. The honor of John Boehner this morning stands in stark contrast to the idiocy of those members who seek to continually divide us. This is something that I actually had a very strong opinion on. They claim that the idiocy of the members who seek to continually divide us. I see that the only idiocy that came out of that was the fact of the continual... The only idiots that continually try and divide us are really the ultra-conservative, the ultra-nationalists, the ultra-patriots, the ultra-Christians, you know, those sorts of individuals who have done nothing over the last few years but stalemated not only the progress made by the Obama administration and the Democrats, but also from moderate Republicans. And it brings up this interesting thing that when you can't get along bipartisan-wise, that's just one thing. That's just stalemated and stagnant and, you know, it's just ineffective government. When you can't agree on policy within your own party, that is when you know the party itself has become stagnated, has become corrupted, it has become absolutely... It's become corroded to the point where it can't function anymore. When bipartisanship fails and the government becomes ineffective and just, you know, can't do its job, then we just realize that we're in a real pickle. When a party is that way, it really signifies that the party itself pretty much has no functionality anymore, and it essentially is pretty much on the verge of imminent collapse if it can't get shit together. So the way that I look at it, when you can't agree on policy within your own party, that's when it just has become absolutely moronic. The teabaggers are the ones that have divided the Republican Party and leading it straight into the sewers of history and dragging this country down with it. I mean, I really can't say anything nice about the whole scenario. When you basically have become ineffective as a political party, the only action that you can do is basically dissolve and start something new. And in this case, I think the Republican Party, whether it crashes and burns or it dissolves in some way, the Republican Party is eventually going to have to make the cut and dry decision. And that is essentially that it is no longer about republicanism. It is no longer about democracy. The GOP itself as an entity, at least the Tea Party itself that basically controls the damn thing, is anti-democratic. They are authoritarian. They are socially conservative. They do not stand for the moral values of Christianity, nor do they stand for the moral values of the founding principles of the United States. They don't stand for any of that. So, them even trying to say that they do and saying that they're patriots is bullshit. So, the fact that they're, you know, the whole fact is of the nature, the Tea Party might as well form itself into its own fascist party and become, you know, basically become the Nazi party of the fucking United States. Or basically just simply, they could call themselves the American Nazi Party, because that's what the Tea Party is. Whereas the moderate Republicans could possibly carry on the legacy of the Republican Party. Granted, it'll probably end up being under some different form. But essentially they're going to have to form some sort of new party, some third party, or even form a coalition with more conservative or even centrist Democrats. So, essentially we could either see a merge of the Democratic Party and the moderate Republicans, we could see a new party itself made up of the moderate Republicans itself, or a new party made up, you know, of a coalition of moderate Republicans and conservative Democrats. Who knows? All I can say is that we definitely are seeing a fracture of that certain political party, and we're definitely seeing a large shift in the American political spectrum. So, it's kind of interesting to hear these quotations from some members of the Republican Party who once were standing up, you know, for John Boehner, that once stood by his side like a fake fucking friend, and now all of a sudden have done a complete 180. And we've also seen this happen with John Boehner and Mitch McConnell, who have basically called out the Republican Party on their own shit and essentially trying to tell them, it's like, we need to get back to where we originally were as American conservatives. And the problem is, I think in some ways it's a little bit too late. But it is a nice gesture, though. So, essentially, let me just reiterate what I'm trying to say and wrap this up in a nice conclusion. There's a lot of criticisms I can make of John Boehner. You know, right on down to, you know, I mean, American conservatism, I could basically bombard with, you know, with criticisms and negativity and insults up the wazoo. But that's not the point that I'm trying to make here. What I'm trying to make is that when it comes right on down to it, from the analysis that I can put forward as a YouTube political commentator, you know, if anything, is when it comes down to analyzing something like this, whether it be fascism, when it comes down to something like fascism against moderate Republican conservatism, you kind of got to go with the lesser of two evils. And in this case, defending John Boehner is a justified thing. That does not mean that it doesn't come with criticisms, as I've laid out some a couple in this video. But at the same time, we should be equally and just even as more critical about the people that have forced him down this new path, that have forced that are forcing the likes of him and Mitch McConnell and other individuals to basically seek alternatives or basically just distance themselves from the party. I mean, this is probably another reason why Ron Paul also probably resigned from Congress a few years ago. Now, as for who is trying to replace, who will most likely replace John Boehner is to some discussion. There are already some discussions that Kevin McCarthy, a representative from California, will probably most likely be trying to take the seat. But there's a lot of different, also very more right-wing, more even teabagger sort of people that are also willing to fill that position. So it's hard to say what would happen. Personally, if I had to pick a Republican to have to serve on the Speaker of the House, Kevin McCarthy would probably be a lesser evil than most other individuals, because most California Republicans tend to fall more along moderate lines. But, of course, there's always that, you know, at the same time, I have my own criticisms about Kevin McCarthy, but I, you know, it at least would bring a Californian back into the House of Representatives, and one that at least would probably be more, you know, at least someone that would definitely fit more of John Boehner's position. That's not saying that Kevin McCarthy won't try to do the same thing that John Boehner did and appease the fascists, but what can be learned is that if Kevin McCarthy does want to step into that position, he might want to actually start taking, you know, joining forces with people like John Boehner and start trying to yank the Republican Party back to where it was. Essentially, though, I think the Republican Party is essentially on its way out, and that this time may be a little too late. That's why I think the Tea Party will try to be, you know, throwing one of their own people forward. I mean, let's even be honest. Ted Cruz, who's trying to run for president, which is moronic given that he was born in Canada, may also be trying to seek this speaker's position. In fact, if anything, Ted Cruz would be the poster child for the Tea Party, on the Tea Party's position, to take over the Speaker's position. But it is not yet known what is going to happen, because all this is just mere speculation and hearsay, so we can't really say anything on the issue as of yet. So all we can really do is continuously watch the Republican Party unravel, as essentially it is going into a very hard-line, hard-fought political season in which most members of the party are actually going to be focused on the issues and trying to, well, elect Trump Fuhrer as president. So it's one of those things where there's not a whole lot of time to focus on trying to give someone the speaker's position. So, yeah, this just comes at a really bad time for the Republican Party. And essentially, it really is throwing the government into a really interesting position right at this moment. So, yes, all we can really do is continuously watch this and monitor this and continue and kind of want essentially see what happens. At the same time, it'll also be funny to continuously watch the Republican Party unravel and watch the purges and everything go out, you know, begin and everything else, and watch the everything just implode. So everybody just grab some popcorn, because this is going to be fun. I'm NorCal Nick, leader of the revolutionist movement, and this has been NorCal Corner. Peace.